Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
All righty, we've just seemed good. We've been preaching on the Holy Spirit. We finished that last week talking about the Holy Ghost and the Paracletos. Hallelujah. And while we thank you, there's peace on that baby. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah, he's going to settle right on down. Yeah, bless his little heart. All right. Amen. Throughout the Word of God, it shows us God's will for us is to have a covenant people who have prosperity and a surplus. God is not interested. You know, we've been struggling too much, too many people, too long. I know it's a bad economy. But God didn't change because the economy got bad. He didn't change his name. He didn't turn in his name and start becoming Jehovah Bad Economy God. All right? He's still Jehovah Jireh, the Lord our provision. Amen? And so we're just going to reiterate some things we've all heard before. And we're going to share some things. Just why? Because when the struggles come and things come against you, the battle is not in whining. The battle's in the Word. Amen. Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. So we go back to the Word. We say what the Word says. Faith comes, we step back into the arena of faith and get out of the arena of doubt and unbelief. Amen. Or the arena of help me, Jesus. Anybody ever been in the arena of help me, Lord? Well, that's not a good faith arena. Amen. That's just a Christian way of saying, I'm in trouble. All right. We got to, you know, we have to do everything from the position of faith. Come on now. You cannot make your stand in a position of fear under the guise that it's faith. Amen. We have to stand in the position of faith. And that's physical health. That is financial prosperity. That is everything in life. We just got to get back into that. And it's every single one. I've done it. We all can slip into that arena of fear or unbelief or reasoning. And, you know, I've been in times in my life where, you know, I really didn't think it. I just said I was. Acting in faith to go to a meeting and Dad Hagin say something, you get slapped upside the head and go, okay, I'm not in faith, not even pretending to be in faith. I guess get back over here, get back where I need to be. You know, get arrested by the Word of God. So this morning, hopefully we'll arrest you if you need to be. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's look at Deuteronomy chapter 28, chapter 28. Never did tell y'all where to go, did I? Deuteronomy 28. Now it says here in verse 12, look what it says here. It says, well, we could back up a little bit. Let's just read this whole thing. This is really a good thing to read. And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments, hallelujah, bless his little heart, he'll be all right, he'll get there, amen, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, let me stop here. How many of you have ever read Joshua 1:8? This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate therein day and night. What? That you may observe to do. Come on now. That you may observe to do according to all that's written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and thou shalt have good success. When? After you've meditated and you've observed to do. See, there's a teaching out right now in the body of Christ that it doesn't matter what you do. We're under the new covenant of grace, and it just doesn't matter what you do. You're going to get blessed no matter what. That's not a biblical principle. I said that's just not a biblical principle. No more than people just get saved just because God's going to save no matter what. They're just going to lay there and, you know, they're going to do whatever they want to do, and they're going to get saved. No, you have to act in faith. You respond to the message. And the Bible, and throughout, and listen. Well, you're reading out the Old Covenant. Go over to Corinthians. It's either the first or second. I'm not right off the top of my head. Chapter 9. And it says that God, you know, let every man sow according as he purposes in his own heart, for God loves a cheerful giver. But it says this, that, you know, he that soweth sparingly shall reap sparingly, and he that soweth bountifully shall reap bountifully. Now, you can't tell me that what I do doesn't have anything to do with how much I financially harvest if the Bible tells me in the New Covenant that it does. If I sow bountifully, I'm going to reap bountifully. So what's this? We have to walk in accordance with the Word of God. And the Word of God has teachings that are fundamentally throughout the Word of God the same. Now why? Because God doesn't change. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Did you know God hates sin in the old, new, and the coming covenant, and whatever's coming? He still hates sin? Doesn't mean that it's ever okay. Now, he's provided an answer to sin, but it doesn't mean he accepts sin. No, he provided the answer for you to accept the answer, not so you could keep doing it. You know, where sin does abound, grace does much more abound, does not mean, you know, go ahead and sin, there's more grace there. Paul wrote rhetorically and said, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? So, or reckon yourself. Remember, the Bible goes on and says this, reckon yourselves likewise to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ. What does that tell me? That although I'm reckoned to be dead, I can live in it. And if you do, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. Saying this, there are people who say there's no such thing as New Testament commandments. That's just hogwash. And I don't have time to teach on all that. But you know, the Bible tells the children obey their parents for this, and the Lord, for this is right. It's the first commandment with promise. What's the promise? That it may be well with thee, that thou mayest live long on the earth. You say, well, I'm under grace. I'm going to live long on the earth no matter what. Well, Paul said, didn't say that. He said disobedient basically won't. All right? So when we see commandments in the Bible or the mindset of obeying God, we are to obey God. Bring all the tithe into the storehouse. Prove me now here with, saith the Lord. I don't believe in tithing in the New Testament. Well, let's just rip Hebrews out of your Bible then. Because the Bible says that he, the Lord Jesus Christ himself, talk about him being after the order of Melchizedek. Melchizedek received tithes of Abraham. Jesus receives them. He says, there he receiveth them, the Lord. Talking about heaven. He receiveth. What's that? Now, that's King Jimmy for present tense, receives. All right? So forget the stupid stuff. All right? There are biblical principles. And here, if you will obey the commandments which I command thee this day, what does, hold your place here. We've already quoted Joshua. Go over to Psalm 103. I'm sorry. Psalm 1, 1 through 3. That's a few chapters off, isn't it? Or a few psalms off. Just 102. Blessed is the man who walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of the sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. Now, what does that mean? That means listen to people who walk in the Holy Ghost and don't listen to the people who don't. Young people, do not go get your dope smoking, drinking buddies to get, you know, fornicating friends to get answers on what you should be doing in life. That goes for you old folk too. They don't have wisdom. They'll tell you, well, I'll tell you what I think. My opinion is this. Well, I don't care what your opinion is, and what they think don't matter. We don't listen to the ungodly, the scornful, or the sinner. They don't have counsel that'll help you. I mean, you go somewhere, I'll tell you what I'd do. Well, I don't care what you would do. Because what you would do will get me in more trouble than I'm already in. As a matter of fact, listen to people like you is why I am where I am. No. You don't need to. What? But his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law does he meditate day and night. And he, who? Not the one who went to Jimmy's counseling services. Not one that called up Sister Vera. Prosperity is my gain. You know, have you ever noticed, I go down to Eastern Carolina, they got all these little mobile homes that are run down and got a sign out front, you know, palm reading, you know, counsel on prospect, on finances. I'm thinking, why in the world would I stop at your trailer to get counseling on my finances? Hello? I mean, it seems like to me, if you got so much insight into all that, you would have gotten out of that mess. Hello? You don't go into the neighborhood with $3 million houses and there's a sign out front. Palm reading advice on finances. I've been down, look, I go all over Eastern Carolina. I got all stuck out there in the country, all over the place. That's where I grew up. I know what I'm talking about. I yet to see one lived in something that you want to live in. But they got wisdom. No, they don't. I said, no, they don't. So we're not going to get our counsel or wisdom from those places. We're going to get it from, but he that delights in the law of the Lord, in his law does he meditate day and night. He'll be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. Hello? His fruit, he'll bring forth his fruit in season. See, it doesn't do you any good to bring it forth out of season. It fall off too quick or whatever. I mean, you start bearing fruit in the middle of the winter, it'll freeze and dry and die, and you won't get anything. His leaf does not wither, but whatsoever he doeth to show up shall prosper. See, God's interested in your prosperity, but see, there are steps you take as a believer to walk in prosperity. Amen? Now, biblical prosperity. Biblical prosperity is not, you don't give an offering today, when you walk out the door, there's going to be $100,000 waiting for you. Now, I'm not saying God won't bless you with some kind of, you know, crazy thing, but I am telling you, we got to stop acting like, you know, counting our money. Brother Hagin used to say this, and none of the other guys listened to him. He's talking about, you know, the thousandfold return, the thousandfold anointings and all that kind of stuff, you know, and you give a dollar, that means a thousand's coming. You give $10, that means, you know, 10,000's coming. You give 100, 100,000's coming. And, you know, people start, and they'll get in those kind of services with that kind of, and they'll just start throwing money in. Under the guise that they're going to get 100, you know, a thousandfold. I remember one guy got television, I got a thousandfold anointing on me tonight. And he asked somebody at the top summit meeting, have you ever received 100? Because he kind of thought that the hundredfold return was not necessarily money, the way people teach it. You know, have you ever received a hundredfold return? They said, I believe I have. That's 10,000% when you figure it up. It's 10,000%. Now, I think we get detracted with some of this stuff and get off base instead of just doing what we're supposed to do and letting God bring line upon line and precept upon precept and us prospering in the way that God told us to do. We get caught up with counting up how much we're going to get back next week. That's because you gave a dollar in offering and somebody hands you $100 when you walk out. Does not mean that was a hundredfold return. Now that's some quick seed return. Now we've got to be a little more balanced. Amen. And listen, if we put our faith out there in something that's not really clear, that way, it's going to be hard to receive. We put our faith there and stuff, you know, supernatural, I'm going to be debt free, supernatural, I mean, sudden debt, supernatural debt cancellation, I'm going to be out of debt next week. I'm going to give this offer, I'm going to be out of debt. And most of the people aren't. I've seen too many. Now, if you'll give and you'll tithe and you'll do the things of God, God can and will bring you out of debt. I believe that God will bring you out of debt. See, we keep waiting for somebody to walk by and pay off a loan. We keep waiting for the bank to send us a letter that, you know, somebody, they don't even know who they are, came in the bank and had your name, they, you know, had your name and address and telephone number and paid off your loan. And we're waiting on that instead of continuing to plant and harvest and God working and God bringing us out. Now, if you want to know where I stand much more in the line of where Dad Hagin used to teach, what I consider a more balanced position of prosperity than some of the other guys are teaching. If you want to know, you want a really good view, go get the Midas Touch and read it. Let me say something. Dad didn't die a pauper. I said, Dad didn't die a pauper. Amen? I mean, they brought the money in, they ran the ministry. And listen, his son had to pick up the mantle and he had to run with it. He had to believe God out of the mess where people quit giving because dad went home. They lost $10 million the first year dad went home in support. You know what you tell me? You didn't love him to start with. If you believed in what he was doing, you'd have kept supporting what he was doing, not him. But pastor took the mantle. He saw it through, and it won't easy. He believed God. They're still there. They're still doing. They're growing and bigger and better than ever. Hallelujah. Whatever you do will prosper. Anyway, so I kind of got off on that. Let's get out of this crazy mindset. We got people putting their faith in something that the Bible doesn't really promise. Let's put it in what it does promise. And if it does end up being a supernatural debt, in other words, you wake up one day and somebody paid off your debt, glory to God. But if you're putting your faith in something that there's not really a promise for, you know what will happen? You'll get disappointed. And hope deferred makes the heart sick. And you'll keep putting stuff off, and all of a sudden you'll wake up, well, why haven't I gotten all this paid off? Why is this still going on? Why am I still tithing and I'm not getting results? No, you are getting results. But you're putting your faith out there in a place that, you know, we need, let's come back. Let's just say, God's going to prosper me. Amen. Then let's start believing, you know, that he'll do this. You know, but let's do it in accordance with the word and not. I've seen too many people try to start out that they're going to get $1 million return. And they can't even get gas in their car. Hello. Are y'all here? You going home? Well, pastor, I believe in God for $1 million. Can you give me $20 so I can get home? Wait a second. You got your faith out there for me? Yeah, I gave and I'm believing God for $1 million. Well, why don't you just back that down a little bit and believe God for $20 because that's what you need to get home with. Oh, well, that went over really big. Let's come back in here. We are going to talk about prosperity. All right. Where were we? How far? We didn't get back. Let's get back over here to Deuteronomy 28 now. That's what I got. I got out of Deuteronomy 28. I just wanted to show you a couple things. Look, I know it's chilly outside, but it is getting smoking hot up here. Hallelujah. Look. Somebody hung tobacco leaves up there. We're curing them out right up there. These about the right size. Put some tobacco sticks up there with some tobacco and hang it right up there and we cure out. You ever seen a tobacco worm, Benny? Yeah. That was a joke. Okay, you people watching my television, there's really not tobacco hanging up there. So, do all his commandments, which I commanded this day, that the Lord will set thee high above all nations of the earth, and these blessings shall come on thee. And overtake thee, if thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God. Blessed shalt thou be in the city. Now, folks, can I say something? Let's stop making things in the Bible say things in the Bible didn't say. It didn't say that you'd be a multi-trillionaire in the city. It said you'd be blessed. Now, I'm not trying to talk you out of believing God for prosperity. I am trying to get us to where there is a biblical basis to believe. Because if you don't have a basis of belief, you can't have faith. Amen? I said you can't have faith where there's no biblical basis of belief. It's not faith. What is it? How many have ever read the book by Dr. K.C., Frederick K.C. Price? Anybody know what K.C. stands for? Knowing Christ. Now, Dr. Price, the year before I went to Rhema, or 2 years before I went to Rhema, he came to Rhema and did a week-long seminar called Faith, Foolishness, or Presumption. Now, for the next number of years, every time the new student body came in, they had to watch that, well, they videoed it, they had to watch that series. Why? Because we were crazy. That era of charismatics was Looney Tune. We were believing God for all kinds of stuff. I mean, you know, you're casting calories out of food. Believing God they wouldn't get pregnant and having sex. Come on now. Come into Dr. Price's office and say, we got a problem. What's that? We're pregnant. Well, yeah, but we were believing God we wouldn't get pregnant. Were you doing what you had to do to get pregnant? Yeah, but we were believing God. Based on what? Well, we can have what we say. Yeah, but the Bible says be fruitful and multiply. And that's the be fruitful and multiply method. Hello. I said hello. Are you? Said some woman came in there going to eat at a fellowship or something, and she was, you know, overweight. And he said something to her. She said, and he heard her praying, "I cast these calories out in Jesus," and then ate like a pig. You can't cast the calories out of food. Hello. So where there is no biblical basis for faith, there is no faith. So your confession becomes foolish or presumptive. One of the two. So go read the book. Go get the book and read it. It do you good. So I think it would do our generation good to go back and read some of the stuff that our generation read, the new generation. Do them some good to read some of the stuff our generation was reading. It'd help them if they would receive it. A lot of them won't receive. They think they know everything. They think the old guys don't know nothing. Baby, there ain't nothing new under the sun. That's Bible. Hello. Y'all hear where we're going home? With me? We have to have a biblical basis for it to be faith. So what do? Find scripture the Bible says that you can live under an open heaven. He said he'll pour out blessings on you. You don't have room enough to receive. Well, I'm going to tell you, some folks, your bank account's so small, it don't take a whole lot to fill it up. What do? You keep growing. We have exceeding growing. Our faith needs to grow. Our capacity to receive needs to grow. We walk into some service where somebody says, "Yeah, there's a thousandfold anointing on me tonight. Run down here, and there's a thousand." And a preacher did it. A well-known prosperity preacher did it. I tell you his name, but you know, I don't want to do that because I'm not out to get him. I'm talking about what they said. People running there throwing money. Thousandfold anointing tonight. Believing they had a thousandfold return because they gave that one service. Isn't it amazing how they didn't get up and say, "There's a thousandfold anointing over Faith and Victory Church. They go over there and give." They're anointed to receive, you know, to cause a thousandfold anointing. Too self-serving. I said it's too self-serving for my taste buds. They're the one with the thousandfold anointing. They're the one getting all the money. And where do you think that money came out of? Church folk. And where does that money not end up? In the church. Well, that person thinks that they're going to get insinuating they're going to get a thousandfold. They're going to bring that tithe to you, and it doesn't ever happen. No, all right. All these blessings will come on you and overtake you if you'll hearken to the voice of the Lord your God. Blessed shall you be in the city. Blessed shall you be in the field. Blessed shall you be the fruit of thy body. Blessed is the fruit of thy ground, the fruit of thy cattle, the increase of thy kind, the flocks of thy sheep. Blessed shall thou be thy basket and thy store. Blessed shall thou be when thou comest in, and blessed shalt thou be when thou goest out. The Lord shall cause thine enemies that rise up against thee to be smitten before thy face. They shall come out against thee one way. They shall flee before thee seven ways. The Lord shall command thee blessing. That's the blessing of Abraham. Glory to God. Now listen, all that I said was to not to be compromised, but to bring balance to excess. There is the blessing of Abraham. Amen. Amen? But let me say this. Abraham obeyed God. Abraham walked uprightly before the Lord. Abraham did that which was right in the sight of the Lord. You go study him out. So he was extremely rich in cattle and gold and silver. Okay? But you know what? He was running the whole team out there, man. And he was preserving a nation. Let's just stay in balance. Let's not get caught up with stuff. So the blessing, which blessing is there? I'll command the blessing upon thee. That is the blessing of Abraham. And surely I will bless you and bless you and increase you and increase. Now notice that the Bible says, in blessing I will bless thee and increase, and multiplying I'll multiply thee. Or the Wayne says, I will bless you and increase you and increase you. What is this? This is a steady growth. Because you have to grow into prosperity. Now, one of the things Creflo Dollar said a number of years ago that I thought, well, this is one of the best things he's ever said. Money is a magnifier. There's some folks, they went out and won the lottery and got $87 million. You wouldn't even recognize them in a year. Because all the stuff they've been suppressing, all the stuff they've been hiding that's really down in that they haven't dealt with and taken care of through the Word of God would come out. Remember that guy a number of years ago won it You know, I think his granddaughter was murdered, did he get killed or something? He died. He'd go into, now this guy says, what did he say when he first got it? He was going to tithe. Don't know that he ever did. He'd walk around with $500,000 in a briefcase and go into, you know, places and gamble and all this kind of stuff. What happened? All of a sudden, all the stuff that he had never dealt with, money magnified it. Cripple said, money's a magnifier. You don't have the right character, it'll magnify it. And let's face it, folks, can we get really real here today? There's a lot of folk who believe in God for prosperity and who really have no intention of living godly with it when they got it. They got all kinds of plans they plan on making and using it for. They might say, lip service, I'll tithe on it, but what they're really going to do is they're going to go live lasciviously. You won't see them in church ever again. Maybe on their second world tour, stop in, you know, to say, hey, I've been around the world 3 times in the past 4 years. Where you been in church? Hadn't been in church. I've been touring the world. Hello? That money will magnify those things. That's why the Word of God tells you what? That the Lord will bless, cause the blessing to come on you. The blessing of Abraham came on him because he was obedient to God. Ever say Abraham was obedient to God? He was told to get out of his country, out of his kindred, and go to a place God would show him. He did that. Amen. He was in obedience to God. He walked with God, did what God told him to do. And even when he messed up, he repented and got those things straight. But that's why blessing came on him, the blessing God promised him. Hallelujah. And in all thou settest thy hand through, he shall bless thee in the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. The Lord shall establish thee a holy, what kind of people? Holy. People unto himself, as he has sworn unto you, if... Here he goes again. Thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord thy God and walk in his ways. You cannot not walk in that. That's a double negative, I know, but you cannot not, all right? You cannot not walk in the ways of the Lord and expect to be blessed. I'm under grace. I don't care. You cannot walk contrary to the ways of the Lord and expect blessing. Hello? Where was I? Verse 9, if thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord and walk in his ways, and all the people of the earth shall see that thou art called by the name of the Lord, and they shall be afraid of thee. Now, somehow or another, we think if we've got a lot of money, people are going to be, people will think we're God. I've seen some people go out and claim something was a blessing of the Lord, and they had blessed themselves. You know, I don't really think there's anything wrong with you going out and getting a car that you want. But don't go out and tell everybody the Lord gave this to me. No, if you've got 72 months car payments, the Lord didn't give it to you. You went out and bought it and put it on time. That's fine. Hello? Or the Lord's brought me to a place where I'm able. Now listen, he can't bring you to a place where you're able to afford to buy something like that. You know, buy a car and put it on credit. You know, but you know, we kind of get weird with stuff sometimes. Let's not be weird. Right? We can turn the air conditioner back now. It's cooled off. Hallelujah. But if the people of the earth are going to see that you are called, let me say something here. There is more that to you, to people seeing that you are called by the name of the Lord than the car you drive or the size house you live in. Because I'm going to tell you something. All that don't mean doodly squat if you're living unholy and living ungodly. And everybody say, yeah, ouch, amen, oh me, or help me, Jesus. That's a good help me, Jesus point. When the people see you walking upright and godly through the difficult times of life and you continue to maintain your integrity and walk right before the Lord, even when it doesn't look good, they'll see that you're called to the name of the Lord. And they'll see God bringing you through where there was just no way you could have come through. They'll see you're called by the name of the Lord. They're not going to just necessarily see you're called by the name of the Lord because you got on the latest power tie and you drive the hottest, coolest, latest, you know, power car on the market. Or you live in the most fancy neighborhood there is on the planet. That does not equate to being called by the name of the Lord. We put so much emphasis on the money side. And God wants us to prosper. And I'm going to get to that. There's more coming. But we got to make sure we approach this from the right mindset. Prosperity entails more than how much money you have. Because if you got all the money in the world, what does the word say? What good is it if you have all the goods of this world and lose your own soul? What? You didn't have prosperity. You had money, but you didn't have prosperity. You go to hell, it doesn't matter how much, you can't take a penny of it with you. Your hand-tailored suit's going to get burned up on the way out. Hello? Your Lamborghini will be at some point in time will be melted by the fervent heat of the elements of the earth. None of those things will matter in the end. So we have to make sure we approach this right. God does want you to be financially blessed. God wants to prosper you financially. But do not put all of your emphasis on that it's going to be money. We have to, number one, start with the prosperity of our soul. Beloved, I pray that you prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospers. Notice that physical health and financial prosperity or prosperity and the other things of life was in direct correlation to how your soul prospered. How's your soul going to prosper? This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth. Thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that's written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. Renewing the mind of the Word of God, having the mind settled in the things of God, having soul prosperity is the beginning place. You don't go there after you get the money. You go there before you get the money. Did y'all give them Nerf guns or anything for us today? I mean, am I going to get shot on the way out? Think about it now. Think about it. Soul prosperity is not what you do after you get money and get the houses and the land. Soul prosperity, in other words, the restoring of the soul, the renewing of the mind, comes before, because when it does come on the other realms, you can handle it. Your character is intact. Your integrity is made manifest. You won't live lasciviously and take that which God blesses you with in the natural and use it wrongly. Hello? They've got pastors who got so wealthy in their churches, and they're going to go write books in other cities, and they're having homosexual encounters with masseuses because they've gotten everything. There was something in them they didn't get straight with the Word of God. Had to leave the church. Step down out of the pulpit. That went over big. Amen. I know I went to school with a guy. Used to fly around with the top prosperity group in charismatic circles. Preach. Church. Lost his first church in that city and his wife. Found he's beating his second wife. They still got a church down there. He got a church down there in that city. I think it's either the second or third one down there. And just got shut down by the city as being a nonprofit organization because it was nothing more than a glorified nightclub. Advertising during spring break, come as bare as you dare. That's exactly what they were talking about, coming naked. You know? And that what you gave was an offering. So it was tax deductible. City went investigating. It's nothing but a nightclub operating under the premise of a church. And this guy's running it. I know him. Or knew him. I don't know him anymore. I don't know who he is. That ain't the person I knew. So that's not the person I knew. So the city's taking their tax exempt status away from them. Well, they should. It's not a church. But see, you get teaching things wrongly, and you got all of a sudden money starts flowing, and you got all this money, and you don't have the character, and you don't have the integrity. You didn't get soul prosperity. You didn't renew your mind. That is why, folks, you need to be renewing your mind while you're believing God to grow and to prosper and to flourish. You need to be renewing your mind to the Word of God. You need to understand that God calls you a holy people. We're going to live separated lives. We're going to live right before the Lord. We're going to honor the Lord in everything we do. And everything we said, even when he blesses us and prospers us, amen? What did Abraham do? They tried to give him money and tried to do this. He said, I won't take it because I'll not have it said that any man made Abraham rich. When he came back from the slaughter of the kings, the Bible says this, that he met Melchizedek and he gave him a tenth of all. First thing he did was tithed to the priest of God. But he wouldn't take money from the ungodly because he said, I'll not have it said that you made Abraham rich. His integrity. See, what we'll do is, oh man, glory be to God. Hallelujah. Abraham, you're not going to be able to go out here and tell them that you made me rich. Everybody's going to know it's the Lord's hand on my life. And I'm going to tithe whatever comes in. I'm tithing on that. First thing he did, met Melchizedek and gave him the tenth of all. Can you say amen? So the Lord shall establish a holy, everybody say, holy people unto himself, as he sworn unto thee, if thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord thy God and walk in his ways. And all the people shall see that thou art called by the name of the Lord, and they shall be afraid of thee. And let me, it ain't just because they got a lot of money. They were walking in the ways of God. They were walking a holy life. We got the new mantra in the church today: live like the world, be like the world. They'll come to the church and they'll think you're cool. But they won't think you're called by the name of the Lord. They might fill your seats up in your auditorium, and they might throw some money in there because it appeases their spiritual need to appease the spiritual need they have in their heart. But they will not know that you're called by the name of the Lord. You might tell them that you are, but they won't know it. Because your life doesn't demonstrate, and your life doesn't manifest a holy people who walk in the ways of God. You're walking in the ways of the flesh. You're walking in the ways of compromise. You're walking in the ways of the world. You're walking in the way of the secular humanists. You're walking in the way of those who will not take their stand for God and will compromise anything they can just to get the money they want. And be able to declare a form of success. They deny having a form of godliness, they deny the power thereof. I'm going back home, Pastor. That's all right, you heard it already. It's too late. And the Lord, who? Those who walk in his ways, who are called by the name of the Lord, shall make thee plenteous in goods, and the fruit of thy body, the fruit of thy cattle, the fruit of thy ground, and the land which the Lord sware unto thy fathers to give thee. The Lord shall open, the Lord shall open unto thee his good treasure. Who? You can't jump in here at verse 12 and start claiming that if you're not doing the other verses. Come on now. You don't get to claim 12 as a New Testament promise when you're not doing one, which is the Old Testament commandment. Hello? It doesn't work that way. This isn't the grocery store where you pick and choose. This is a whole package. Ever say the Chop House or some of these places will have a dinner special during Valentine's or something like that, and you can't make any substitutions. It comes this way, and that's the way it comes. I called them at the one time. I said, look, I don't care for the greens. Can we get double mashed potatoes? Nope, no substitutions. I told the person, are you kidding me? I can't get mashed potatoes instead of them field green things? Nope. Won't be there. My choice is, it was a take or leave it offer. I had to leave it because I wasn't interested in doing it that way. I'm not going there paying that kind of money, and all I can get is field greens instead of mashed potatoes if I want double mash. That was my principle. But you know what? They had their principle, and their principle was we don't make substitutions. God has principles, and you may not like it. And his word might say that you have to obey the commandments to get... Where was I? I lost my page there. The Lord shall open unto thee his good treasure, the heaven, to give rain unto thy land in the season, and bless all the work of thy hand, and thou shalt lend to many nations, and thou shalt not borrow. And we got a lot of people running around confessing that who haven't obeyed the commands that he commanded them to do. But they're claiming 12 and won't do one. I said they're claiming 12 and they won't do one. Now, I know this is good preaching on prosperity, but you like the part where you get the 100-fold return. Just hold on to your back seat. Grab a hold of your caboose. Amen? The first thing is, if we don't establish some of these things, people will still hear what they've heard all their life. We've had people teach us stuff in the church for decades that are wrong. And we get mad at the people outside the charismatic word of faith prosperity circles for pointing it out and say, no, they just don't know what the Bible says. And really, they were right about some things. One is you got to have the right attitude about money. You don't have the right attitude, it's going to hurt you. Hello? There's something that happens to people who don't have the right attitude when financial blessing comes. They get into error. They'll get into error about their thinking. They'll get to where they think they run the show. You don't run the church just because you got money. I'm just telling you, you don't run the church just because you got money. I don't run the church just because I'm the pastor. The Holy Ghost runs the church, and I walk in obedience to Him. Amen. He told me to start Winston-Salem. I know some people got upset. I can't help that. He told me to do it. As a matter of fact, He told me when I wasn't even listening. Or planning on, I was talking to the person, said, look, you know, why don't we start a Bible study over there? And, you know, we'll come over and do a Bible study once a week. And they said, yeah, that sounds great, 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 great. And then I was kind of talking, and all of a sudden I went, and we'll start a church in February on Sunday mornings. Who said that? Well, ain't nobody else in the room. And, of course, they're on the other side going, that's what I've been praying for. Glory to God. I'm going, oh, Jesus. I just set myself up for it. But God told me to do that. I didn't do it because for the fun of it. Amen. We changed to 9 o'clock, but before 9 o'clock, we were getting up at 6:50 on Sunday mornings to get over to Winston in time. So went to 7, went to 9, got up at 7:20. I thought, oh, praise the Lord, this is better. My mind just loves that 7 better than that 6. But you know what? We're blessing people. We're doing, God told us to do it. So your money is not why we do things. I've lost people because I wouldn't do what they wanted to do. They thought they could run me, and I wouldn't let them run me. They took the money and left. Had them do it. And it hurt. It hurt financially. It hurt the church. It hurt our ability to do things. But I will not be beholden to somebody thinking because they've got money, they can do what they think. They can run the church. They can come tell me how to run the church. You can't tell me how to run the church. God tells me how to do it. I do what God says do. And if you don't like it, I can't help it. But that's where we learn to have the right attitudes in life. That's where we will renew our mind to the Word of God and understand submission to authority and understand the role of biblical leadership, that our money doesn't run the church. God's blessed you. They got that money. Praise God. And you're tithing it. Praise God. That doesn't give you any upper hand over somebody who's tithing a 20th of what you're tithing. Why? Because we have to maintain the right perspective about things, have our minds renewed to the Word of God and think the way God says to think, and to have the right attitude about it. But I'm telling you, when you don't do that and you get money, people start thinking they can do things that they're not called to do. I had a woman tell me when we first moved here, she was right on one side. When we changed over here, she came and told me that my tithe pays half the rent of the church. Now, in pure numbers, she was right. In biblical terms, she was wrong, dead wrong, totally wrong. Why? Because your tithe goes to the Lord. It does not go to pay half the rent of the church. That's God's money. So you don't get to claim I pay half the rent of the church. Now I love the people I got here. I don't have any trouble. Now, don't you think I'm talking about anybody here? Nobody here has given me that kind of trouble. They're all gone. They've all left over the years. And not that I wanted them to, but I will not bow down to your lack of renewing your mind to the Word of God to understand your role in the church with the right attitude that the money that you have that you give to the kingdom is given to the kingdom and you don't get to tell it how it's done. That's why most liturgical, not liturgical, most congregational rule churches, the board is made up of all the rich people. Not just because they know how to handle money, they're running everything. They're used to running everything. So they think they're going to come in there and they're going to run the church the way they run their business. And there's a factor, unless they run their business by the Holy Ghost, there's a factor you're leaving out. You don't get to call the shots when the Holy Ghost says, do it this way. So we're going to build prosperity from this place. We're going to renew our mind. We're going to think right about money. We're going to understand what place it has in our life. We're going to think about where God's blessing is bringing us, and we're going to think of it in biblical terms so that we keep ourselves humble, we keep ourselves submitted, we keep ourselves under the hand of God. We do it the way God wants it done, and then when that money is flowing through our hands, we handle it with integrity. We handle it with biblical principles. We handle it with the right heart. and it becomes a blessing. Let me ask you all something. Do you think for 1 minute that the Kennedy money has been a blessing? That family has, they call it the Kennedy family curse. They've had all that money. They've lived in lascivious lifestyle. In fact, they don't even get taxed on that. Most of that money is sitting in a trust, and the house they live in is in a trust. The cars they drive in is in a trust. They get very little cash out where they pay taxes. The majority of that money is in a trust. The estate, they just live off the estate. They basically live free off the estate. Now, there's some. But think about what has happened in that family from that money. Two sons assassinated. Their grandson killed in a plane crash. Somebody was killed skiing, or got injured seriously skiing. One daughter born with really bad brain problems. They tried to do a lobotomy and messed her up. Hello. One cousin just got found out for rape and murder. They charged him. On and on, and then you know the senator that was in, he just his money's the only reason he wasn't in jail. I mean, all the stuff that he was involved in, I was like, there's been no blessing in that family because of the money. Well, where did it come from? It came from illegal bootlegging back. We know that. It came from the bootlegging back in the Prohibition era. They made their money, got into a trust, and it got hidden, and they couldn't do anything about it. It was not being blessed prosperity. So it's not prosperity. It's wealth, but it's not prosperity. So we had to think, well, you shouldn't say, listen, this is Paul. Everybody knows this. This isn't something that's kind of hidden. It's all out there, and you can go find all this information. So I'm not talking them down. I'm just trying to use you as an example. We talk about how great that family is, and you go look at the tragedy it has been through in that wealth. No blessing. There's been no blessing. I said, there's been no blessing. Where can you find all the blessing? Well, they became famous. La di stinking da. The Kardashians are famous. Hello? They call them socialites. I'm like, what? What makes them a socialite? Oh, the media wants to be able to make money off of their antics. So they call them a socialite because they got money. Money, wealth, does not make you prosperous. So let's establish that at the very beginning of this as we teach on this. That is not prosperity. Prosperity starts first in the soul and grows from there. And it will include finances. But it is not finances. And because we didn't do this right, we didn't lay the foundation right. People started running after money, and then those people who came along, those who lie in wait to deceive, began to use the teachings on prosperity to line their own pockets and get extremely rich under the guise of teaching a message that's going to help God's people. Anyway, it's there. It's clear podium. I need one that's not clear. Anyway, line their pockets, and people keep throwing money thinking they're going to get rich next week. They're going to get rich next week. They're going to come out of debt. Oh, praise God, I gave this money, and now I'll never have any more financial problems, and they got more financial problems next week than they ever had before. We're going to start right. Amen? We're going to view money as part of the overall plan of prosperity. I'm going to prosper in my soul. I'm going to prosper in my relationships. I'm going to prosper in how I conduct myself with my church. You know, I'm going to be submitted to spiritual authority. I've had people who would say, you know, they wouldn't even call me pastor. They would call me by my first name. And they tell people, well, that's our pastor, but, you know, they're our friend, too. Well, that's, I need to be your pastor. I need to be able to speak into your life with authority without the fear that you're going to pack up and leave the church with your money. I need to be able to come and say, you're out of line. As the authority of the pastor. Well, don't tell me what to do. Pack up and leave. I've had people, not just one, two, several have done that over the years. You can't speak into their life. But I'm the pastor. I'm supposed to be speaking into your life. I'm supposed to be able to bring correction and instruction and righteousness into you. I'm be able to say, you got the wrong attitude here. Well, you can speak about life anytime you want. And then when you do, come on now. See, because that money attitude's wrong. It becomes, without people even knowing it sometimes, it becomes a control mechanism they use to control others. Even done preemptively, they'll do something to bless somebody and then they come back later because there was a string attached. But because they're doing something financially, they can't respond the way they would normally respond if there was. If it was a poor person doing it, they'd tell them where to take it. They tried that on them. I'm just telling you the truth. They had tried on somebody who didn't have any money. If somebody didn't have any money and tried that same thing on that person, they would have never stood for it. But because somebody had some financial clause into them, they listened to it. They tempered the way they handled it. This is not Bible. This is not how we can conduct ourselves. And listen, preachers, we have to bear responsibility because we didn't teach it right. But people, I'm going to teach it right so that you are equipped that when the devil tries to come with this garbage, you say, no, God's prosperity is more than just how much money I got. Part of his prosperity is your relationship with your local church and your submission to the pastor. Now, you understand biblical submission, not this crazy stuff. I don't care. If you want to go to Hawaii on your vacation, go. If you want to go next week, go. It's none of my business. Amen. Now, if we've got a meeting plan for a year and you decide you're going to take off and go miss the meeting just because you want to go do something, I might have something to say about that. You needed to be in that meeting. That was for you. It wasn't, you know, well, I just want to go to Hawaii this week. Well, you don't need to go this week. You need to be in the meeting. Amen. Because they're coming in to minister to you. They're coming to bring something to deposit in your life. Hello. I've had people miss meetings because they didn't like the person we brought in. What? Just suck it up. I'm not rambling. I'm telling you things that'll help you. And it's time I stop Mickey Mousing around and not just being real straightforward. You think I'm just going to get blunter as I get older. You know, now, number one, we love you guys. You're awesome. We love the people who've left. We love people who are coming. We love everybody. But here's the thing. You know, people, I don't know if anybody's saying anything to you about anything, but I'm going to tell you something. We love the people who've left. Can I tell y'all something? The people who most recently, in the past year, all the people who've left in the past year, I personally sent them a message and called some of them, inviting them to come to Shekinah Glory, saying, look, I know you're gone, and I don't know all the things, but let me say this. We want you to feel free to come to the doors of this church and receive ministry because what we have coming in can bless and help your life. Personal. Not an email from the church, text message, or a phone call from me. Just so you know. If anybody says anything about I didn't do this and I didn't do that, it's not true because I personally did that. Didn't have the kids do it. Didn't have somebody send something. I sent personal ones. Because I love you and I want you here because this will help you. Okay? Because we believe in people. And we believe in God's ability to restore and whatever. Doesn't mean they may come back or whatever. I don't want people missing something that God has because they're an offense against me or whatever. I don't care about that. If they can get help, if they can get ministry, it'll bless their life. That's more important than anything. Amen? Glory to God. It is. It's more important than anything. One person that kind of left, not real recent, but in the past year or so, I called them. I said, look, I know you didn't leave on good terms. When y'all left, it was caustic. But I want you to know that the doors are open for you to come because we want you to be able to minister to. We love your family. We love you and da-da-da-da-da and so forth and so on. They didn't come, but I tell you, the door was open for them. So just in case you're wondering if people try to portray me as some kind of jerky hard nose. See, stuff like this, and sometimes people don't tell people this happened. A lot of times they won't tell it. Some people left our church a long time ago. I called them, said, look, love for you guys to come to the meeting. I know you loved them when you were in the church. You liked their ministry. We want you to come. Now, one of the couples did come. The other one couldn't. They said, you know, and I said, oh, okay, that's fine. Here's the links to watch it on the line. And one night was watched. I know they told me they watched it one night on the line. Yeah, well, because we love people. All right? So, your relationship with your church is part of your prosperity. The relationship to the pastor is part of your prosperity. Your relationship with your spouse is part of your prosperity. When I say spouse, I mean man with a woman and woman with a man, not any other way. Not two men or two women or one, a man and his dolphin. You think I'm joking? That was just in the news. For a year, him and his dolphin. Mm-hmm. Yep, like flipper dolphin. We're getting sick. It's getting sicker and sicker. Why? Because darkness is getting darker and darker. But your relationship with your spouse, your relationship with your children, all that is part of your prosperity. So you can have all that money and not have any of those things. You're not prosperous. I said you can have all your money and not have the right relationship with your church. You're not prosperous. You can have all that money and not have the right relationship with the pastor. You're not prosperous. You can have all that money and not have the right relationship with your husband or your wife. You're not prosperous. You got money, but you don't have prosperity. Why? Because prosperity brings peace. I said prosperity brings peace. And you can have peace without money. But you can't have peace with broken relationships. You can't have peace when you're out of line with the will of God. You can have money, but you can't have peace. Everybody say, right on, preacher. So I said, preach it some more. I wasn't going to say any of this morning, but I say I like Dad Hagin. I come with the skeleton, and he let him put the meat on the bones. And that's what he did this morning. Now, we're going to get into him opening his good treasury next week. And tonight, Jeff is ministering. Hallelujah. I'll be ministering Wednesday night and Thursday night. Hallelujah. Next Sunday begins the first of the month, so we'll have our healing rally. Glory to God. Amen. Then Jim Hockaday is coming in on the Wednesday the 20th. Mark Shell the 31st. Fifth Sunday Fellowship on the 31st.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fbc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.